I've got a question for you. Have you ever been on Instagram, and as you are liking some picture of a friend, all of a sudden you notice that there are a few dots underneath the picture, and you realize that this isn't the only picture. There are multiple pictures behind it. So what do? You want to see what else is there, and so you kind of swipe to the left, and you begin to scroll through each picture. Now, sometimes the pictures are kind of random, and they may seem even disconnected, like there's no real rhyme or reason to this collection. But you have to search for the common thread that ties them all together. Sometimes there's a line or a paragraph that's written, so you kind of know what ties all this together. You're probably like me. We all have a friend or two that say they feel like it's their calling in life to post every course of every meal, of every day, of all the different things that are taking place, because they know that everyone will just be fascinated to know of what they're doing, right? But usually these groupings of pictures are a look back at maybe different events from a weekend trip, or a variety of pictures from a tournament that your child was in, or maybe it's a recap of a family reunion that you attended, or a party with your friends. What we're going to do today is we're going to take a look in Mark chapter 8, and I'm just telling you ahead of time that we're going to cover a lot of different verses and four different events during a few days in Jesus' life. And we're just going to kind of scroll through Mark's Instagram as he's going to kind of take us on this journey through some random activities. And I want you to be on the lookout for what might be a common thread that is woven throughout these different experiences. So as you turn to Mark chapter 8, we're going to see that this is a study of four different people who caught Jesus' eye. Now, how did they do it? What were the different groups? We're going to go through those four different groups, and we begin with the very first group, and that is people who were in need of bread. I want you to follow along in your Bible or on your mobile app. We'll look at Mark 8. We'll look at the first few verses 1 through 3. In those days when, again, a great crowd had gathered and they had nothing to eat, he called his disciples to him and said to them, "I have compassion on the crowd because they have been with me now for 3 days and have nothing to eat. And if I send them away hungry to their homes, they will faint on the way. And some of them have come from far away." Now, as I begin reading this passage, some of you are probably nodding your head and thinking, wow, this sounds really, really familiar. I think we've already covered this passage. Well, it's very similar to the feeding of the 5,000 men that we learned about back in Mark chapter 6, but this is a different event. Let's keep reading. Look back in your Bible at verse 4. "And his disciples answered Jesus, 'How can one feed these people with bread here in this desolate place?' And he asked them, 'How many loaves do you have?' They said, 7. And he directed the crowd to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves, and having given thanks, he broke them and gave them to his disciples to set before the people, and they set them before the crowd. And they had a few small fish, and having blessed them, he said that these also should be set before them." Now, it seems like a deja vu moment, right? But while it's similar, it's a very different time, it's a different location, it's a different size crowd, but the result will be the same. Look at the next verses 8 and 9. "And they ate and were satisfied." I just love that verse. "They ate and were satisfied, and they took up the broken pieces left over, 7 basketfuls. And there were about 4,000 people, and he sent them away." Now, we learned the last time that back in that culture, they counted the men when they counted an attendance. And so we have no idea how many women, how many children were there. But same thing happens on both situations. The crowds are mesmerized by Jesus' teaching. They're mesmerized for so long that they didn't bring enough food with them for as long as they were going to stay. And in this particular case, Jesus taught for 3 days. So Jesus is truly worried about some of them just having a hard time on their trip back home. And the disciples' response seems pretty similar to how it was in the feeding of the 5,000, because their response is, hey, how in the world can we feed all of these people? We don't have much. And that had to be a terrible disappointment to Jesus. After what he had just done, weeks or days before, what short memories they had. But Jesus keeps his cool, and he realizes that the disciples and us at times are really slow learners. You know, in Mark chapter 6 and 8, we are still continuing to learn how to count. We talked about this a few weeks ago. Remember the lesson that we learned? Have this massive crowd there, and Jesus says, well, let's see, what do we got? What do we got? And they say, well, we got five loaves, we got two fish. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then 6, 7. And we talked about how Jesus was probably wondering in his heart, why don't you count to 8? Why stop at 7? I'm right here. And Jesus is trying to get them to continue to count to the only person who can make a difference. They've not yet exhausted their resources. They haven't tapped into Jesus yet. And both times they count their edible elements, but they stop short of counting on the one who can make the difference. And both times Jesus pulls it off somehow. Let me remind you that bread back then was the main staple of that culture. Bread represented provision, sustenance, security. Everyone needed bread. And so if you had bread, it had a financial significance in that time period. You say, why? Well, because every single meal that they ate had bread involved in it. It was central to most every meal. And so Mark concludes this first section with a transitional line that's going to show us that it's time for us to swipe to the left. Look at verse 10. And immediately, Jesus got into the boat with his disciples and went to the district of Dalmanutha. And so they hop in the boat and they go across the Sea of Galilee. And we swipe to the left and we see a second group that catches Jesus' eye. And that group is the adversaries who wanted more than bread. The enemies, the adversaries of Jesus who wanted more than just bread. We refer to these people as religious leaders or the Pharisees in this particular passage. Look at your next verses in verses 11 and 12. The Pharisees came and began to argue with Jesus, seeking from him a sign from heaven to test him. And he sighed deeply in his spirit and said, why does this generation seek a sign? Truly, I say to you, no sign will be given to this generation. So they want more than bread. They want a miracle that comes down from heaven. It doesn't count in their minds what Jesus has been doing, these incredible miracles right there on the earth. They say, we need something that comes down from heaven, a sign from heaven. We need something from above. We need something to come down from another world. And they fail to realize that Jesus is right there in front of them and he fits all that criteria. That's exactly who he is, sent from God, from heaven, as a sign to be a living representation of living a perfect life. And for some reason, there are people who, when Jesus does things and Jesus reveals himself, it's just not enough for them. They're just not willing to humbly bow their knee and acknowledge that there is someone wiser, more powerful. And so they just keep saying, produce more evidence. You know, give me a sign. Now, let me just say from the outset of this conversation that there's nothing wrong with putting a fleece out before the Lord. We all have prayed and said, Lord, will you make your will clear to me. I don't know what to do with this job choice. I don't know with this dating relationship. I don't know how to handle this friendship. Will you make it crystal clear to me? And we say things like that, and we ask God for a sign, or we put that fleece out and say, will you lead me in the direction? There's nothing wrong with that. This is different. And here's how this is different. If we were to understand this in the original language, the way this is written, they are not asking Jesus for a sign. They are demanding one, and they are telling him. And it is self-serving because they want to be able to say that, well, we asked for this, and we got it. And Jesus knows their tone, And if Jesus were to give in and grant this request for them, he would be condoning and rewarding a bad request that was poorly motivated, that was rooted in presumption. And all throughout the Bible, it's a humble faith that leads to spiritual blessing. Now, there is one sign in the Gospels that Jesus says to the scribes and Pharisees that he will give. Matthew chapter 12, verse 40, Jesus says to the scribes and Pharisees, he says, this is the one sign that I'm going to give you. And the sign is, for just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. So Jesus is foreshadowing his resurrection on the third day. And now when he said that, you know, people didn't understand what he was saying. They couldn't put that together. But what he did in that instant when he said that was he called his own shot. He called his resurrection, and he does this throughout the Gospels. He lets people know this. They don't understand it at the moment, but later when Jesus comes back from the dead, they're going to go, oh, he said he was going to do that. He kept his word. And back here in Mark chapter 8, perhaps the bigger reason that Jesus didn't give them a sign is simply this. If he would have, then he would be removing faith from the equation and coming into a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And all throughout the New Testament, we see the necessity of faith, of complete trust in the salvation experience. And even if Jesus had granted their request, they probably would have said the next week, you know what, give us a more spectacular sign. Because their hearts were so hardened, it wouldn't have been enough. They would want one more. They would want one more. Do you know people like that? I had a friend that went to lunch with him. He just said, I've been investigating Christianity. This is several years ago. He said, I just really want God to show himself in a really big way. So he said, I'm just asking him for some big sign. He said, I'm just asking him in a very clear way to reveal himself to me so that I know this is the route that I need to go. And he's one of these guys that is very deep and intellectual. I gave him some different books that I thought would be good resources for him. I tried to answer some questions for him as well, and I told him I would be praying for him. It was several months later. I hadn't talked with him. I'm in the middle of a worship service at my church back then, and I glance in the baptistry, and he comes out and he is getting baptized. And I was just thrilled. And so I raced to the back and caught him as he was coming out from there. And I said, dude, I said, I had no idea. I had no idea you were giving your life to Jesus Christ. I said, tell me what the big thing was. What was the big thing? How did he reveal himself to you? And he looked at me with his hair soaking wet. And he said, you know what? It wasn't one thing. He said, it was a whole lot of little things. He said, and it got to the point where there were so many little things that if I added them all up, they were bigger than any one big thing ever could have been. God will find a way into your heart if you seek him with all of your heart. That's what it comes back to, is are you willing to take that step? Apologist Norm Geisler says it like this, fill this in on your outline. God doesn't ask us to take a blind leap of faith into the darkness, but he does ask us to take a step of faith into the light. Well, here's our next transitional verse that prompts us to swipe to the left. It's verse 13, and it says, and Jesus left them, got into the boat again, and went to the other side. And that leads us to the next section where we will see, thirdly, Christ's followers who were confused about the bread. So there's going to be some confusion that takes place on this boat. Notice they've gone back and forth over the Sea of Galilee now. And in verse 14, we pick it up and we're going to find out what this confusion is about. Now, they had forgotten to bring bread. They probably left in a hurry. They had forgotten to bring bread, and they had only one loaf with them in the boat. And Jesus cautioned them, saying, watch out. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the leaven of Herod. And they began discussing with one another the fact that they had no bread. So Jesus says, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. That seems like a pretty clear warning that, hey, these guys are dangerous. Watch the things that they're teaching. But the disciples misunderstand, and when he uses the analogy of leaven, they think that he's talking about the fact that, oh yeah, one of us forgot to bring bread, you know, thanks a lot, Thomas, you know, or whoever it was. And so they have in their mind these physical things, these earthly things. They think he's talking about the one loaf of bread. Sometimes we try to communicate something to someone and things get lost in the process. I guess it's back about 20 years ago when email was just catching on. There was a businessman from Wisconsin who went on a trip down south to Florida, and people were still kind of learning their way of how to navigate through an email account at the time. As soon as he got to his hotel room, he immediately opened up his laptop and he sent a short email message back to his wife, Jennifer Johnson, to let her know that he was okay. But in his haste, he mistyped one character in the email address, and the letter went to a Gene Johnson in Iowa instead of his wife, Jennifer Johnson, in Wisconsin. Now, that wouldn't be a problem, except for the fact that Gene Johnson was the wife of a pastor, and he had passed away earlier in the week, and he had just been buried that day. And the pastor's widow came home from the cemetery. She checked her email, and she read a brief message. And at the end of the message, it said, signed from your hubby. And she immediately fainted. You know why? The message said, arrive safely, but it sure is hot down here. P.S. Looking forward to your arrival tomorrow. So we misunderstand. At times, there's miscommunication. We understand when we think the message is clear and obvious, but it isn't received the way that we intended. But Jesus has communicated this pretty clearly. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, and it just goes over their heads, and the disciples are confused. But when Jesus says leaven, he is referring to the teaching of the Pharisees and the Herodians. And he uses this metaphor because both yeast and teaching, they operate invisibly. It's kind of beneath the surface. You don't know what the effect is of your teaching. You don't know what's going on beneath the surface. It's the same way with yeast or leaven. Beneath the surface, you don't know. And yet both have the potential to dramatically affect the surroundings. And so Jesus realizes the danger of religious leaders who have a self-serving agenda. And let me say, a preacher or a teacher or a Bible study leader in this church, you have the opportunity to sway people's opinions and to manipulate the way they think. And this is a strong warning to all of us. And so let me just say as clearly as I can, you weigh everything that I say. You weigh everything that is said from this pulpit. You weigh it against God's word. And you don't take anything for granted. And you don't say, well, it must be right because she said this or he said this or, you know, my Bible study group or my C group leader said it, whoever it might be. Hey, you dig into God's word. My constant prayer is, Lord, help me to teach and lead out of clean motives, out of a pure heart. There's a passage in the book of James where it says, not many of you should presume to be teachers because you will have a more strict judgment. And it's because it's something we can't take for granted. And Jesus is warning these disciples, hey, these guys might be the religious leaders of our day, but I'm just telling you, beware. Because there is this dangerous legalism and self-righteousness that is being quietly advanced beneath the surface by them. It's leaven, it's invisible, and it might not be detected by the casual observer. Look at verses 17 and 18 in your Bible. They think that they're talking about the bread, you know, we got one loaf of bread. Jesus, aware of this, said to them, why are you discussing the fact that you have no bread? Do you not yet perceive or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Having eyes, do you not see? And having ears, do you not hear? It seems to me that Jesus is giving them this gentle rebuke, and they're concerned about not having enough bread. And if you think about it, you can see why Jesus is rebuking them. He's wanting to say, come on, guys. You're the same 12 guys who were here with me a few weeks ago when we had 5 loaves and 2 fishes, and I fed 5,000 men plus women and children. Come on, guys, you were with me just a few days ago. And with just a few days ago, I had 7 loaves, and I had a few fish, and I was able to feed 4,000 men and who knows how many women and children. Don't you think that with 1 loaf of bread, I can do something for a dozen of my closest friends? And he just is bringing it back before them. So Jesus is saying, guys, this somewhere falls between comical and ludicrous. And so Jesus is going to give them an impromptu math lesson. And I think that they probably have their tails between their legs. Listen to this in verses 18 through 21. Do you not remember when I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000? How many basketfuls of broken pieces did you take up? They said, 12. And the 7 for the 4,000, how many basketfuls of broken pieces did you take up? And they said to him, 7. And he said to them, do you not yet understand? I mean, they had to feel badly at that point. But I got to tell you something. If I would have lived back then, if I would have been a follower of Christ, if I would have been one of these disciples that was right there with him, I got to tell you, I think I would have missed a lot of these things too. I just think that now we have the benefit of being the Monday morning quarterback who knows the rest of the story as we look back. But in those settings with these veiled references and explanations, I don't know if they would have made sense to me. Well, there's one more picture that Mark posts for us, and it's the final swipe to the left, and it's the 4th snapshot. And here we're going to discover a blind man who encountered the true bread of life. Look in your Bible at verse 22. Mark chapter 8. And they came to Bethsaida, and some people brought to Jesus a blind man and begged him to touch him. And he took the blind man by the hand, led him out of the village, and when he had spit on his eyes and laid his hands on him, he asked him, do you see anything? And he looked up and said, I see people, but they look like trees that are walking. So Jesus does this miracle. This man who is blind gets limited vision, and when Jesus touches him, and instead his vision is not totally clear, it's struggling. He sees forms in motion. He sees people that resemble more like trees. Let me just let that sink in. Now let's go on to verse 25. Jesus laid his hands on his eyes again, and he opened his eyes. His sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. And he sent him to his home, saying, do not even enter the village. Jesus probably didn't want another crowd and mass of people to come at that time. So he said, don't go back through the village or the city. You just head on home and rejoice. Now, we got to talk about this, because typically when Jesus does a miracle, I mean, let's be honest, it's a ta-da moment, right? I mean, it ends with applause, it ends with tears of joy, it ends with gasps of people saying, this is unbelievable. But this one, it seems like Jesus kind of missed it the first time, and he needs a second chance. And some of you are really squeamish right now, and you're thinking, yikes, I mean, Jesus is the perfect Son of God, and yet he didn't perform the miracle correctly on the first try. I mean, I know he was tired. I know he's had a lot going on. I mean, bringing someone's sight, even limited sight, I mean, that's a miracle, I guess, right? It's just not the Jesus that we've come to expect. But don't lose your faith over this. Modern technology and surgical procedures, and the more we've learned about the human eye, paint a very different picture. You see, with the human eye, you see, even when healed physically, it still needs training. It still needs rigorous practice before they can transmit what is real and what is not real. And the brain, in a sense, needs to be recalibrated and reprogrammed, just like a little infant when they open their eyes. You ever watch them as they open their eyes for the first time? They're just kind of focused. They're trying to take things in and what's going on. And that's my dad. Yikes. You know, they've got all sorts of thoughts going through their mind. We don't know what they see, but they're trying to learn to focus over the period of weeks. Dr. Keith Mano, a distinguished eye surgeon, tells of a 50-year-old patient of his named Virgil. Virgil was blind since childhood, But then he had successful eye surgery with Keith Maynell. And weeks later, he said that he felt even more disabled than he had after the surgery, even though he had eyesight now. You say, why would that be? He said, well, steps were just such a major thing for him, and corners and angles. If any of you all have ever had eye surgery, you know it takes some time for that to come back. And he would even look at an animal or a pet, and he would see it in different sections rather than as a whole. He would look at a tree, he told his wife, and he said, I can't put the tree together. I see the tree top, or I see the tree trunk, or I see the leaves, but he couldn't put it all together. It took him 5 weeks before his eyes were able to adjust to where all of a sudden he could see things all together. And he said the tree all came together at that point. Dr. Maino goes on to say this: this is irrefutable evidence that a miracle took place in Mark chapter 8 and Bethsaida. Because no one, if they were fabricating this story, would ever say what he said. They would have said, oh no, I can see fine, everything's great, if they were making it up. But he said the fact that he said that the people look like trees walking is virtually the exact same phrase that Virgil said after his surgery. So what some liberal theologians and skeptics have called a half a miracle from Jesus wasn't a half a miracle. It was two miracles. He did the miracle to start to give him back his sight. And then secondly, he took what takes weeks for the eye to adjust to, and he did it in a matter of seconds. Because time is nothing to the one who is the Alpha and Omega, the one who is timeless. And as we've swiped our way through this together, I want you to see there are two recurring themes in this lengthy passage of four different stories, all right? The one theme that I see that keeps repeating itself is that of blindness. There are a lot of things that people should be seeing that they don't throughout these four episodes. And I like the way John MacArthur traces this common theme of blindness through these four pictures. He writes about this passage, and this is what he says. He says, it is no coincidence that the healing of a physically blind man immediately followed the demonstration of permanent spiritual blindness by the spiritual leaders and temporary spiritual blindness by the disciples. I never would have pulled it together that way. But there's still another theme throughout this passage, and it pops up several times, and it's where I want us to spend the remainder of our time. In fact, if you have been taking notes, it stands out to you very clearly, and that is the recurring mention of the word bread. And bread is all throughout this. And let's be honest, the longer we are alive and the more we eat, the more we just kind of begin to see bread as something that is boring and something that is basic. And when you need to be filled up, you dive into some bread if you need some carbs. So I've got some bread right here, and it actually looks pretty good right now, because I could eat that right now. But bread is kind of boring, right? It's a little bit bland when you see it all by itself. So what have we come up with now to make that bread just a little bit more enticing and to attract us? Well, we put different things on top of our bread. And I've got three different things here that I think are really great things to put on bread. By the way, I call this the Tommy Kreitz section of my sermon, okay? Started to say Rachel Ray, really, but okay. This right here is cinnamon butter. And I don't know if you guys ever go to Texas Roadhouse. I think you guys have Texas Roadhouse. I'm telling you, I could make a whole meal on this, and you put this on top of that bread, and you just kind of smooth it around a little bit, and every once in a while you get some on your fingers. Accident. But when you see that right there, your taste buds right now, you can picture what that tastes like. And it is delicious. When you look at cinnamon butter, it's kind of like, man, I don't think I could make it without that cinnamon butter, because it is so, so good to taste. But maybe that's not your cup of tea. Well, here's another one. You go to an Italian restaurant, and they have a different concept. Instead of putting something on top of the bread, you're going to sop that baby, right? And so what do? You get some of this stuff out and you pour it down, you pour it on a plate, or a server comes over and does this at Maggiano's. Is that how you say it? 1, 2, 3. Maggiano's. Oh, hey, I'm sorry. Golly. I can misquote a scripture, but if I say Maggiano's wrong, okay. I guess I touched a button there with you all. Whoa. And after they pour this on there, what do they do next? They take this and they just crank that pepper all over it. And then you take your bread and you sop it all in there and you soak it all up. And in your mind, you know what you tell yourself? Oh, this is olive oil. Olive oil is good for you. I'm eating like a health nut, right? And you have about 5 pieces of that bread. Well, the last one I want to show you is my go-to, and it's what I would go to when I would come home from school, and I would go into the kitchen, and I would get a slice of bread, and I would go to the cabinet, and I would find this guy right there. Yeah, once you see the shape of the bear, your life changes. It's going to be a good day, right? And I would just take that lid back, and I would just get my bread, and I would just start, and I would just keep going. And I'd make my little designs on there, and then once I got one whole layer, I would just keep on going. I would keep on going. And once it stopped again, I'd start all over again. Because it just sinks down into the bread. I don't know if you're aware of this, but look, it actually will sink down, and it makes you want to be a human bumblebee, all right? But the same thing would happen every time that I would be doing this for about 2 minutes. My mom would come walking in the kitchen, and she'd say the same thing every time. She'd say, "Would you like some bread with your honey?" And I knew what she meant. She was saying, "Okay, that's enough. You can stop there. You're focusing in the wrong direction, right?" Now, some of you weren't hungry at all until I started this, and now you're like, "How long is he going to preach?" All right? I understand that. Now I can hear stomachs growling from all the way from Crystal Lake to Aurora that it's taking place. But when you think about all of these different toppings and all these different things that we put on top of here, these toppings have a way of capturing our attention. But these toppings are not real good for you. I mean, I've never had blood work done, and the doctor called me a couple days later and said, "Hey, we got the results from the lab, and I'm going to change your diet a little bit. I want you to be eating more cinnamon butter, all right?" They would never say that, right? But over time, if we're not careful, what happens is that the toppings attract our attention, and soon the bread begins to kind of fade into the background. We've been talking about some different times where Jesus fed large crowds. Let's go back to the very first time that Jesus did that. It's in all 4 gospel accounts, the feeding of the 5,000. And in John chapter 6, we have this long version of the story. We get more details about it. And in John chapter 6, when they get fed this free meal by Jesus, the next day, these crowds, they just start coming after Jesus. And they want to make him their king. They want Jesus to be their king, and you know why they want him to be their king? Because they're going to have free food for the rest of their life. I mean, that meal we had yesterday, that was the first happy meal, right? It's always a happy meal if you don't pay for it. And so they're like, "Hey, this guy is going to be our next king." They find Jesus in order to make him king. Jesus sees them coming, and he knows their agenda is pretty obvious, but rather than embracing it, he is going to expose them for their ulterior motives. And in John 6, verse 26, Jesus looks them in the eyes and candidly says to them, "Very truly I tell you that you are looking for me, not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill." Busted. And the crowd goes on to verbalize what they really want. You think they would say something spiritual in that moment and say, "Well, no, there are other things. We really like your teaching." You think they would say something like that, but they don't. Look at what they say in verse 34. This will blow your mind. "Sir, give us this bread always." In other words, we really like this gig. We'll follow you anywhere you want. Just keep the free food coming. And it's another case of demanding rather than asking. They love the miracles more than the message. He makes them feel good by what he can do for them, and they're in this frenzy because they love the toppings more than they love the bread. And on the surface, that seems so much more exciting to them. And so Jesus says to them in verse 35 of John 6, he says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger. Whoever believes in me shall never thirst. And later in the chapter, Jesus says, whoever eats this bread will live forever. So the Gospel of John has seven I am statements where Jesus says, I am the vine, I am the door, I am the good shepherd. Here he says, I am the bread. Every time he says, I am, this is a declaration of his divinity. He is saying, I am God in the flesh. He says, I am the bread of life. You all are thinking about the food that I gave you. That food satisfies you for a few hours, and then you come back wanting more. He says, I am the one who can satisfy you and sustain you and provide for you for all eternity. I am the bread of life. And Jesus starts laying out his expectations to this crowd if they would be willing to follow him, of what it would look like. I mean, they loved to hear Jesus teach. They loved his miracles and teaching. When he started talking about commitment, though, they lost interest when he said, I want to be number one in your life. I want to be number one above your hobbies. I want to be number one above your pursuits. I want to be number one above your job. Then he says, I want to be number one above your family. So you need to decide if you're going to commit your life to me. To put it another way, he looks at them and says, would you like some bread with your honey? Because I'm right here, and I'm the bread of life if you want me. And the Bible says in John chapter 6, it says that the crowds began to walk away from him, and they deserted him. They walked away because to them, it was all about the cinnamon butter. It was all about the olive oil. It was all about the strawberry jam. It was all about the honey. It was all about the Nutella. But it wasn't about the bread. And as they walked away, it became crystal clear that they wanted the temporary toppings more than they wanted the bread of life. So what's the common takeaway from the illustration of the bread throughout this chapter? What do you see throughout the thread woven throughout this chapter? And the common theme that I see in Mark's Instagram story is this: focus on the spiritual more than the physical. That's where our focus needs to be. If we focus on the spiritual, we stay on the same track as our radical teacher. But when we pursue the secondary more than the primary, when we love the toppings more than the substance, when we crave the miracles more than the message, when we love the bargain more than the bread, we are walking away from him rather than approaching him. Focusing on the spiritual will require a lifetime of commitment and sacrifice. But what you will gain and the legacy you will leave and the lives you will touch far outweighs the thrill of any temporary toppings or physical pursuit. God will do whatever it takes to convince us that his son is the only thing that can truly satisfy. And if you are visiting Harvest today, or if you're watching this online and you are looking for a church, here's what you need to know about the Harvest Bible Chapel. Here's what you need to know. This scripture is our standard. Jesus Christ is our Savior. We will lift him up unapologetically. While our methods will constantly change, our message will never change. Here's our message. Jesus is the bread of life. He is the only one who can satisfy us. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come to you and we ask that you would help us to focus on Jesus, just Jesus. And Lord, when we even look at church and get excited about the great programming or events that are coming up, or the excitement of those things, would you help us see those as events and programs and classes that point us to Jesus? Point is just to you. And Lord, may we never lose sight. May we never be drawn off sides by the temporary toppings of this world. But may we focus and find our sustenance and strength in Jesus alone. It's in his name we pray.